This video was originally recorded at Menla Retreat in Phoenicia, New York, February 2018 at the annual Tibet House US Buddhist Study and Practice Intensive. To learn more about this annual program, please visit menla.us.
Sometimes.
I just hope for human taste, we'll do a rosary together, all of us. We'll do a rosary, and then he's going to do a talk. He likes to do a retreat in the future, maybe a Monte Carlo or something, but I just thought it would be fun. He joined our retreat before he gave the talk, and he was fine. We don't have to, we'll do the Kar Sutra, we'll start with Kar Sutra as we do. And, get a piece of that, and then we'll do a one rosary together, and then do your talk, okay? I think that's how we do it. And then we might, if time is still left, we'll go back to the little bit of retreat again. And, where's my heart sheet? Here it is. Okay, we do it in the Zen way.
Transcendent wisdom, heart sutra, vested, I hear on a single word, a jaja, for with dwelling on the culture, peak and rajender, heart together with great communities of mendicants and bodhisattvas. At that time, the blessed Lord entranced himself in the teaching samadhi called illumination of the profound. Sattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, was realizing the profound transcendence of wisdom, and he realized that his five-body mind processes are void of any intrinsic reality. Thereupon, moved by the Buddha's power, venerable Shariputra addressed the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, thus to engage in learning the profound transcendence of wisdom, how should he practice? In the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, addressed venerable Sharadhatiputra, the Shariputra, when any noble son or noble daughter wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, he or she should realize it in this way. His five body mind process, he should be truly realized to be void of any intrinsic reality. Matter is voidness, voidness is matter, voidness is not other than matter, neither is matter other than voidness. Likewise, sensations, conceptions, mental functions, unconsciousness are also void. Shariputra, the soul things are voidness, signless, uncreated, unceased, stainless, impeccable, undecreased, and unincreased. Shariputra, thus in voidness, there are no matter, no sensation, no conception, no mental function, no consciousness, no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mentality, no form, no sound, no scent, no taste, no texture, no idea. There are no sense media from eye to mentality, sense media, and there are no consciousness media from the visual to mental consciousness media either. There are no ignorance and no cessation of ignorance and so on up to no old age and death, and no cessation of old age and death either. Likewise, there are no suffering, no origination, no cessation, no path, no intuitive wisdom, no attainment, and no non-attainment either. Therefore, Shariputra, because the Bodhisattva is without attainment, she lives in reliance of transcendent wisdom. His spirit is unobscured and free of fear, passing far beyond all confusion. She ultimately succeeds in nirvana, and all the Buddhas who live in past, present, and future rely on transcendent wisdom to reach manifestly perfect Buddhahood in unexcelled perfect enlightenment. Such being, so there is the mantra of transcendent wisdom, the mantra of great science, the unexcelled mantra, the uniquely universal mantra, the mantra that ends all suffering. It is not false, and to be known as truth, the transcendent wisdom mantra as follows: Tadyata Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhisattva. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhisattva. Om Gate Gate Para Gate Para Sangate Bodhisattva. Sariputta Dasyata Bodhisattva, the great hero, learned the profound transcendence of wisdom. Thereupon the blessed Lord arose from that samadhi and applauded the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero. Excellent, excellent, noble son, so it is, so it is. One should practice the profound transcendence of wisdom in just the way you have taught it. Even the transcendent Buddhas will joyfully congratulate you. Blessed Lord has spoken thus, the venerable Sharadati Putra, the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, and everyone in that audience, and the whole world with its gods, humans, titans, and fairies rejoice, and all applauded what the Buddha said.
Now, we just do the very beginning of Bhagavad Gita. Instantaneously, I do it right there, just everyone knows. Instantaneously, I myself become the blue color chakra. That's right there at the beginning. I don't want to read the whole book. The second paragraph is page one. Instantaneously, myself become a blue color chakra with one face, two arms, holding my Raja and now embraced by the universal mother. I stand with right leg extended. Om Mahum Bo Ham Shah. Om Prem Raja Jakini, Raja Jati Shari, Gaganas Bhava, Sarvadhara Vishodhani, Sarvadhara Jnani Vishodhaya Om Prem De. And then we won't do it in offering. We won't do it in Bhagavad Gita. We'll jump down. Protection one, let's do this one. On page 9, do the self-protection one. Or first, do the one of the shedding your skin. You can make Om Ah Hum Ho Ham Sha. Page 9. Come on,
I don't think so. It's
not 9.
It's 2.
It's where you, the, you know, the snake, the moon takes their skin off.
Yeah. Om Ah Hum Ho Ham Sha.
Om Hum Ho Ham Sha Pradyopaya Makam Kaya Vachita Jnana Adipate Mahakaya Vachita Jnana Vachita Shamaka Sabhavam Kuru Kuru Skandana Vata Yatananam Sabhavam Swaha. At my crown, a Vam letter transforms into a Vajra 16-digit full moon sphere, which moves down and up my body 3 times from crown to toenails by changing the skin of the snake. and my body become pure white like a moon sphere. Om Shabbat Shuddha Sarvadharma Sarvada Shuddha Aham. At my crown of chakra, there is a moon disc cushion and a white bone which becomes a white vajra with 17 spokes. At my throat chakra, there is a sun disc and a red ah becomes a red vajra with 33 spokes. At my heart chakra, the mouth disc becomes a black vajra with 9 spokes. At my navel, a supernova disc, a yellow hole letter becomes a golden vajra with 65 spokes. At my crown of space mandala, a green moon becomes a five-spoke green vajra. And at my secret place, at the tip, there is a dark blue intuition disc, and a blue cha becomes a blue vajra with 33 spokes. All these vajras are standing upright on discs in the center of my chakras from top to bottom. From the blazing vajras, there are primary colored light rays shooting in all directions. And my own body becomes a vajra body. I incinerate with the vajra light rays the hosts of devils and destructors. Om ah om ho om sha. Ra 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 ra. Vajrana sarvabhana dhamma pradyasavala sarvamaya kaika vina vinayika dinyam shajadikatanam kaya chachari dhaha 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 dhaha. One by one, all sins I did order of my beginningless, the utter now of God's hatred and delusions. I joyously congratulate the virtues of perfect Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, and holy saints, and all virtues of others. May they turn the Dharma wheel of Vajrayana bead to easily heal beings tormented by addictions and diseases. May they quit the longing for a nirvana beyond all the pains of the misknowing life. And with the pure style of an undiluted life, may they stay on the countless aeons. With the great faith, I take refuge in the Buddha, Master of Supreme Initiation, in his Dharma, his good heart, inseparable, and in his true Sangha, his new life. I completely give myself over to the Lama Buddha and his spiritual children, you most holy of recipients, who please accept me as your servant. May my three times virtues, untainted by self-interest, become the cause for all three state beings to attain the most perfect enlightenment. From now on, may I conceive the spirit and the perfected high resolve that transcends egoism and self-existence. And we'll go through, we'll do the... Okay, Om Shunya, let's just do those four. Om Shunya, Dhyana, Rajasa, Atma, Roham. Om Nimitra, Dhyana, Rajasa, surrounded by the eight Shaktis, with all the nine mandala deities, Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, and then this one. I myself, page 19 of this in my version. I myself am the Lord, Kalachakra, granting consecration of compassion to being. I myself am the Lord, Kalachakra, made of the five wisdoms, crowned by Rajasattva, Aharanti, extremely pure, realm of actual reality. Light rays radiate from my heart and drag all cool living beings into the Buddha. The transcendent father mothers are invited by these heart light rays and merge in my heart. The fire of the great passion of myself as father mother in union now elbows transcendent lords and ladies to spirit of enlightenment. And that spirit of enlightenment emanates from my body's path and concentrates all beings. By the mere touch of the light rays from that enlightenment spirit, the living beings are filled with the bliss of supreme ecstasy and gain the nature of wisdom and art as father mother deities with various faces and colors. And then we can skip to the Chakshi Churchukso. Maybe their aggregates become five Buddhas, the Chakshi Churchukso become five female Buddhas, etc. So then we do all that, and then we go to a drop and rise again. And finally we come to the mantra that we do one rosary the word of the mantra, okay? Om Ah Om Mohamaya Om 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 Ah Om 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 So now, thank you, everyone, and now we're going to take a break, and David is going to give a talk. Let me just introduce him. David Kintay, got his PhD now, how many, 4 years ago?
Seven.
Yeah, 4 years ago.
really, 7 years ago?
I'm fine. Well, that's my sense of time. Right? 7 years ago, and he did a wonderful thing. He translated an entire tantra called the Vajramala Tantra, the Vajra Rosary Tantra, which is one of the five Vyakya Tantras, or explanatory Tantras, of the Guhya, the Vajra esoteric community system. And it is a particularly remarkable one. It also serves for the mother Tantras. It has a
Greg, well, he'll tell you more about it, which was a marvelous achievement that he did. He worked with the help of a wonderful Dalai Lama, we have called us on John's Bell. And then he, since then, he's been teaching both in the core curriculum in Columbia and in the religion department. And he came sort of, he beamed down from outer space. He wasn't an ordinary junior professor, et cetera. He was a lawyer, but a grown person, a mature person in the world with a family. And he came back to education at a certain stage. And he is the most popular teacher in the religion department at Columbia. Mm-hmm. And all the senior other professors other than me are jealous about it. Yeah. I guess these great student reports in the student publication, you know, like how much fun they had, and they have amazing names of these courses that are even enough to flip it out. And so I begged and wheedled him to come up, because he's finishing now the publication version, which we are publishing in our series of the Vajra Maha. And he's been doing a lot of research to settle some very complex things about the central channel, about the winds and everything, which it's all about, in the final polishing and publication. So I asked him to come to the talk. Okay. So I'm going to come up here now. It's a good talk. I'm going to sit there. And he's a descendant of Yelu Chuzai, as Diane knows most about. He's a descendant of a famous Chinese general called Yelu Chuzai, who became Genghis Khan's great counselor. When he conquered China.
Really?
Yeah. And I'll come there maybe afterwards and we'll dialogue afterwards. If there was a source of
it.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. It's wonderful to be here.
So Kite means Kite, it's Kitai, the Russian word for Chinese.
Yes, it's a great word. It's Kitai.
Okay.
Wonderful to be here, wonderful to see you all. Honored to be here. Deeply moved. Awed. Really, to be with wonderful practitioners, with Dala Chakra, such a wonderful system. And to be here with Bob, who actually just came to Harlem and spoke to a whole bunch of people there about anger and Buddhism. And it was really wonderful. It was really wonderful. And you have to know the stories of everyone in order to appreciate the impact of what people have been through.
Really?
Yeah. There was one there's one woman who was very moved by Bob's talk on anger and really came up to him afterwards and asked for a copy of the book. And Bob gave her a copy of the book. And she has quite a history involving anger. Mm-hmm. And I don't need to go into it, but really wonderful. So thank you. Yes, it's true. I was dreaming when I was about 20. I had a dream. It was like a vision, one of those dreams where you just wake up and go, whoa. And I was wearing furs and I was going down the Oxus River. I can say these things here, right? This is great. And I was going up the Oxus River in the winter. And then I was wearing furs and it was cold. This is my dream, which was more of a vision. And then the sun rose from the east and the rays spilled out over the landscape. So I woke up and I went, what? Oxus River? What is the Oxus River? I went and I looked it up in the dictionary and it turned out it was the ancient name of the Amu Darya River, which flows in Central Asia. And so then I started to do some research. My last name is Kite. And I found that the Kites had conquered China and founded the Liao Dynasty. And when Marco Polo went to China, he called it Cathay, which is Kite. And then, as Diane knows better than anyone in the world, maybe, Genghis Khan's prime minister was a Kite. His name was Yelu Chuzai. And he actually saved more people than anyone in history because he convinced Genghis, rather than to kill everyone when he conquered them, he should keep them alive and tax them. He did. So then he ended up fleeing west, and eventually we ended up in the shtetl in Russia, and who knows what happened, and here I am. So it's true. I was a lawyer. I have to confess that. But my journey there was a little bit different, but I'll go into that some other time. So the Vajramala is a very wonderful tantra. And how I got into this was, here's how I got into it. I had gone back to graduate school because I wanted to find my path that I had been on earlier, then I became a lawyer, then I came back. And I was in Bob's office, and Bob said, "What do you think you should do your dissertation on?" And Jensine Anderson was there also. And Bob said to me, "You like tantra, why don't you do one of the explanatory tantras?" And Jensine said, "Why don't you do the Madhya Vajramala?" I said, "Okay." That was in like 2005. Now it's 2018, and I've pretty much been working on it ever since. So it turns out that this kind of random event, this random tantra, is probably the leading source concerning the subtle body, winds, channels, and the conceptualities that ride upon them. And it hasn't been translated. It's widely quoted by Tsongkhapa and in many other, by Rangjung Dorje, the third Karmapa, who did some very wonderful work, was commented on by Jambon Kongtrul. And the Vajramala is the leading source for this. And the Vajramala has 68 chapters, it's rather long. And the focus is on 108 energy winds, lung in Tibetan, sometimes just called winds, as in channels, winds, and drops that you've all heard of. 108. And these 108 form the basis of a yoga by which the yogi first learns the 108, meditates on the 108 to become familiar with them, and then as the yogi moves the winds into the central channel, those winds, which are conceptual winds, which are hindrances to enlightenment, which give rise to all our negative emotions and conceptualities, our nyondrip and shedrip, those winds become actually the sources of wisdom and overcome ignorance itself. And the Vajramala becomes a source text, maybe the source text, for the second of the five stages, as in Nagarjuna's five stages, his Panchakrama, which is the stage of speech, vajra repetition, and speech isolation, which is the gateway to the rest of the five stages on the way to enlightenment. And so the Vajramala, with these 108 winds, is a really foundational thing. Now, according to the Buddhist tradition, Buddha taught Tantra at the same time he taught everything else. And then the scholars got a hold of it and started dating it. And well, were there really two Nagarjunas? One was a Tantric Nagarjuna who lived 1,000 years after the great philosopher Nagarjuna who lived just after the beginning of the Common Era. And the scholars debate all of this. But it's very interesting because you see an evolution of Tantra from an early point, whenever it was, through the present time. And there are many, as you know, you're studying Kalachakra, and there are so many different tantric systems that have different configurations of the subtle body and how you go about doing what you do. Practices which can be reconciled to some degree by the geniuses, the commentators, Tsongkhapa, and Aryadeva, of course, and Nagarjuna, but there's a great deal of, there are many inconsistencies. So, just to give you an idea, I handed out this chart, which has a few of the beginning of the these 108 winds, and then the location and the channels, the type of energy it is, and the conceptualities that ride upon them. Now, when I asked Lhotse Rinpoche, the late Lhotse Rinpoche, a wonderful teacher, about these 108 winds, Lhotse Rinpoche said, we don't study those in the Tantra colleges. We study the print of these 10 main winds, which are the five main winds and the five branch winds, which if you look at the third column here, you'll see the English, Tibetan, and Sanskrit for those winds. And this, the first, you'll see the numbers 1 through 9, and we start with the navel chakra here. But in the third column, you see these different winds. And the five main ones are, of course, the vitality or prana wind, which is the life-giving wind or the life force wind. And then you have the other winds, evacuative, metabolic, ascending. And here it's called cooling. In the scheme of winds, there, of course, are five main winds and five branch winds, but the fifth wind, which is the pervading wind, which is associated with Vairojana Buddha, is only active at death. So it's not included here. So we just have the four main winds and then the five branch winds, which are called up-moving, per-moving, co-moving, surmoving, and ultra-moving winds. So we have this schema, and Tsongkhapa, when he looked at this when he lived in the beginning of the 1500s, Tsongkhapa looked at this and looked at different accounts of the winds and said, it's hard to reconcile. There are a lot of different systems, and he went through this whole thing, and at the end he said, this bears further investigation. There's one main commentary on this Vajramala, or Vajra Rosary, and that was by an Indian pandit named Alanka Kalasha, who in the tradition, as they did, we'd have an Indian pandit working with a Tibetan Lhotsawa, a Tibetan translator. And he worked with Stangpa Lhotsawa, who was a man he had a reputation, Stangpa Lhotsawa did. But in any event, the two of them worked on Alanka Kalasha's commentary. And Alanka Kalasha, after whom I have named one of my four cats, Lami, who's a girl, but that's okay. Alanka Kalasha did this commentary in the 1200s. And it's really interesting when you dig into this. I mean, the genius of the practice, the wonder of the system, as the analogy is, you see a really well laid out city of the Dharma. Well, this is a really well laid out city, but there are some contradictions. So I'll just take you through a couple, just to give you an idea of the kinds of things that we're thinking about here as we try to make sense of these. Because what I'd really like to do, of course, is reconstruct this somehow so we can have the practice of the Vajramala. We can identify all of these 108 energies and the conceptualities associated with them, where they flow, when they flow, because they flow through the different chakras and the different times of the day. And then once we do that, according to the Vajramala, we can then overcome those winds, bring in the winds in the central channel, and they become another mode for breaking through to a whole other level. And I'll talk a little bit later about how we might get to that other level in more modern scientific terms, which I've been thinking about all the time. So, but anyway, take a look at page 2 of this little handout, where we have the chakras and remember, the first column there is the energy wind, or the loom, right? So we have just the first one, we have the piercing flesh. And and then, you know, sometimes Alanka Kalasha was commenting on this Vajramala in an ancient text, that was recovered from Kashmir and somebody paid 300 bars of gold for. But there were many other copies of the text around. And the text originally was in Sanskrit. And like so many of these texts, we don't have them. Why? Because in Sanskrit they wrote them on palm leaves. Palm leaves don't hold up so good in the Indian climate. And so, but when they were translated into Tibetan, when Buddhism came to Tibet, the Tibetans invented their very alphabet from the Sanskrit in order to copy these scriptures, they kept better up there, and then they used block printing, and so there are copies of the Tibetan translation, but not of the Sanskrit. Tiny bit of the Sanskrit is another text, which is wonderful. We find that, we celebrate, and then just as I'll be about to publish this book, the Chinese will produce a Sanskrit version from, you know, the vault in Peking, and then I'll have to do it all over again. So, but that's okay, that would be a good thing. So, so we have here the what might have been the Sanskrit, etc., and we have the location, etc. So the first one is the vitality wind. The vitality wind, according to the Vajramala and the commentary, flows in the center, comes into the center of the chakra, whichever chakra, and then flows through different petals of the chakras. And you know, the Kala Chakra, we were just looking in the sadhana of the, they're talking about the difference in the 65 and the 17, I believe.
Yeah, well, in the Kala Chakra, the eight shaktis,
yeah,
the eight of the ten winds, and then the central Kala Chakra figure is the two more.
Yeah.
So the Kala Chakra and Vishnu Maha have the ten winds in the, as the Kala Chakra, embodied the ten winds, those shaktis.
Yeah.
The eight shaktis.
Yeah, so, but you'll find slightly different variations in many of the different tantras,
yeah,
in different places, different names, etc. So anyway, so we're looking through this. The first column is the vitality wind, and of course, the conception which seems to run with this wind, which is called piercing flesh, is dishonesty. And then the next one is horrible, right, which is located in the great jewel, right in the heart chakra.
Yeah.
Great jewel, and it's the evacuative wind, which makes sense, because it's Ratnasambhava. Ratnasambhava is associated with the evacuative wind, with the the laziness or deceit associated with it. Now, now I'm reconstructing, to some degree, which conceptions go with which winds. Not easy, because the accounts in the commentary and the Vajramala, they're slightly different names.
Yeah.
I'm working on it. Mixed up. Now, but then the next one, this drunken argument wind. See that one in number 12? Which is associated with the great lotus channel and the metabolic wind. And the problem is here that normally that would be associated with the Mogha Siddhi. But here, the commentary says it's associated with the Lapa Kalasha. The next one, the drunk with desire wind in the great Vajra channel, should be, and with the ascending wind is normally associated with Amitabha. Here, it's associated with the Mogha Siddhi. So what was the problem? Was there an error in the commentary? Is it a different system, etc.? So these are what we're trying to figure out. And it's difficult to figure these things out because, as I've looked through the literature, the descriptions are slightly different. Often, these channels have colloquial names that differ from system to system, and it's very hard to reconcile. So what are we talking about? Real, here we have the Vajramala, the system of 108 winds, which seems to be absolutely fundamental, which seems to be a practice which has been, to a great degree, lost. And so what does it mean? So let's go a little bit back. Because, and we have any physicists here? Any physicists?
Just us.
Okay, well, I'm no physicist either, but over the past several years, I've done a lot of reading in the area of quantum mechanics, which is dangerous. You know, this was really big in the 60s with the Tao of physics.
Yeah.
And it was really big in California. I can't help it. I spent a lot of time in California. Okay, but so about 1905, 1910, there was a complete revolution in science. The revolution of quantum mechanics. And quantum mechanics is now used to do a great many things which we rely upon in daily life. But quantum mechanics completely upended our understanding of what matter was. It used to be, like in school, even when I was in school, this is 30, 40 years after the quantum mechanical revolution, we learned about atoms and electrons and particles, and everything is made up of smaller and smaller particles. And that's the way it was. And so we had this thing called consciousness that no one really understood, and still no one still really understands what it is. Some people say it just comes out of complexity, and therefore artificial intelligence will soon be conscious. Stephen Hawking and others say this could be a big problem. This could be the end of the human species within the next 10, 20, 30 years. So think on that. Consciousness used to be the mystery, and matter, we knew what it was. But people like Erwin Schrödinger and Niels Bohr and Einstein in 1905, 1910, figured out that it wasn't like that. What they did, and they verified this through experiments, was they found that what exists only exists when we observe it. And that before that, things just exist as probabilities. In other words, you can't know the location and momentum of a particle at the same time. You can't know that. It's only when things are observed that we cognize where something is and what something is. This is, of course, a little bit related in the same family relationship as Buddhist mind only or Yogacara thought, which says that things don't exist separately from the mind that engages with them. Right? That things are empty of being separate from mind. Okay? So the quantum revolution found that things just, there's just kind of, you might call it a quantum foam, just a background of possibility that only comes into effect when we observe. And this is real science. This is it. This is what this is. So of course, when the great physicist John Wheeler, he had a theory. He called it it from bit. Meaning it, matter, comes from bit, information. And this has been fairly widely adopted, though of course there are lots of theories about what quantum mechanics is and what it means. So if things only take shape, only exist when we observe them, then what could this have to do with what we're doing here? Well, when we do a sadhana, when we do practice, we engage in intense observation. Intense and repeated observation. And in the creation stage, what we're doing is we are visualizing ourselves, in this case is Kala Chakra and Vishwamata, or it could be other deities, could be Chakrasambhara, Vajrayogini, whatever the deity is, Yamantaka, intensely. Now, if it is true that things only take shape when we observe them, then it could be that the process of the creation stage is actually to create the subtle body. Because until we, by repeated observation, observe and measure and perceive the subtle body and our identity as a deity, and we do it wholeheartedly in detail with divine pride, until we do that, it's very inchoate. It doesn't really exist. And that's why it could be that when someone who hasn't practiced intensely and well, an ordinary person like me, would meet his end as the coarser body elements dissolve and then subtler body elements dissolve, then what becomes most paramount are those instincts, what I've been observing. And since what I've mainly been observing is grasping at things and chasing after things, then that probably will determine my fate, either in the last few minutes of my life or in the next life. Okay, so this could be a way to think of the creation stage, and this could also be a way to handle thinking about all these different systems, because after all, the knock that atheists put on religious people is, wait a minute, all these systems disagree, right? So it's got to be that 98% of these people are wrong. But it could be, if quantum mechanics is right, and of course, now we're in the era of quantum mechanics, so we all think that's the rage. In another 50 years, it'll probably be something else, but here we are. We have to start where we are. So here we are, so if we can develop, so what I was saying was, if this is a way of reconciling all these different systems, because it could well be, if you practice Kala Chakra, and you intensely devote yourself to that practice, what you're doing is creating a subtle body according to what you are in a disciplined way observing in Kala Chakra. Therefore, when you're ready to practice the perfection stage, there's something there. You have created it in a scientific way by your disciplined practice. Right? It also can explain faith. Faith is also a kind of visualization, a kind of observation. So if someone lives
faith.
So if someone has great faith in Jesus or Buddha or whatever, then it could well be that they are setting up the conditions for actually engaging with those things. And this could account for some experience. Yes, Diana?
Santa Claus.
Santa Claus.
Don't
we create it? We do create Santa Claus, and then Santa Claus becomes real for us. And you know, it's even more fundamental than that. Because when we observe anything, against the backdrop of our own biases, psychology, and cultural conditioning, right? And so we all enter the game with a common kind of observation of the quantum foam, because we're all culturally conditioned. Now, it might be different. I might have certain biases or psychological proclivities or hang-ups, and so they make me look at things differently. So then we get into what becomes central in Buddhism, which was the topic of Bob's, you know, wonderful essence of eloquence, and that is, how can we start to get a little wiggle room from this kind of constricted worldview that we have, that is, both individually and collectively, creating the world we're in. Right? And the answer to that is a Greek word. The Greek word is hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is the science of interpretation. Okay? And only by starting where we are can we then start to get a feeling for how we might be free of that. It's like the great graduation speech that David Foster Wallace gave at Kenyon College, where he talked about there's two fish swimming along, and one fish says to the other fish, "How's the water?" And the other fish says, "What water?" Right? And so the first thing to do is to realize that what you are cognizing, what you are seeing, is the product of your conditioning. And once you realize that, then you might ask yourself, is there another way to look at it? And when you talk to another person, you might find another way to look at it. And so by that process of continually examining your own worldview, how come I react the way I react right now to that? How come I understand that the way I do right now? What is it about me? Why do I see this as this? And Susie and I were walking and she saw some snow on the ground, said there's a giraffe on the ground. Right? And that's cute, you know. But why? You know, why? It's like a Rorschach test, right? So anyway, and it turns out that the great philosopher Heidegger, he brought hermeneutics, it was originally just about the Bible and about law, in other words, how different biblical passages contradicted each other. So how do we reconcile them? And the same laws apply to different cases. How do we decide what's the right application? But then Heidegger said, no, we have to apply this to all experience. All experience. And Heidegger supported the Nazis, right? But because he thought that National Socialism might be a new way. But he was focusing, as the good German philosopher he was, simply on ontology, simply on being, on the philosophy of it. And he wasn't, and it took Nishitani, his disciple, his student, who was a Zen person, to really complete the circle with Heidegger. Because without compassion, any level of wisdom will lead you nowhere. You must have compassion. But let's get back to the quantum phone, okay? So observation is very important. And so let's see how this might work, because it also could explain karma, okay? Yeah, yeah, what is that? Right, thank you. So let's, you know, in the tantric way, we go through the dissolution. We do this in our sadhanas. And the dissolution first, you know, earth dissolves, and water, then fire, then wind, then consciousness, and then we have the three states of luminance, radiance, and immanence, also called appearance, red increase, and near attainment, and then clear light. Right, as we either go to sleep, or we die as yogis deliberately, or we die as non-yogis, however it happens. Right, so this is, and then once we're in clear light, then, and I'm riffing now off of the yoga of the three purifications, although this is the same in all unexcelled yoga tantras, right, but. So we go to clear light, right? And some people say, oh, clear light, just visualize it as a vacuity. Okay. Maybe let's do this a little bit slower. Can we do it a little more slowly here?
Yeah.
Let's do it more slowly.
What?
Let's do it a little more slowly. It's a dissolution. We'll do the dissolution more slowly. Okay. So let's do the dissolution together. Okay, so here we are. Okay. And you know, I think everything's cool, but it turns out that not so cool. And so, and what happens, you know, according to the Tantra is first the earth element dissolves, and so I have as the earth element, that element of stability leaves, the next most prominent element is water, so I see things like a mirage, like a watery mirage. And, you know, if you're doing the letter hum is dissolving, you know, depending on, which tantra you're using, you know, the letter hum will. But, you know, but first, so I go from my body to maybe a column of light where water is predominant, and then the water dissolves. And when the water dissolves, the next element that's most predominant is heat or fire. So that what appears to me is smoke. And you know, say in Chakra Sambhara, then a little hum in my indestructible drop there, smoke. And then as the heat dissolves and the heat leaves my body, right, then the next predominant element is energy or wind, and I just see, you know, sparks. See, but here's the thing. All of these, what we're doing, is against the background of this kind of quantum foam. Okay? I call it a quantum foam, but it's the unobserved quantum state. You know, if you take a vacuum, and you put a Geiger counter in it, it will register energy. We call that the zero point energy. Because in this quantum state, before we observe it, there is everything. Every potentiality is there. And so when we go from earth to water to fire to wind, we're simply observing in a way that's conditioned by our bodies and our karma and everything else, that configuration of the quantum state. So then, when this energy, the fireflies dissolve, the next is consciousness. And so the general vision is that you see this like a candle in a pit, and you just see the flickering. You see the candle itself, you just see the flickering light. And that's where these 81 instincts, they dissolve in consciousness, and then now your consciousness is gone. And now your mind becomes identical with luminance, which is like an autumn moon, just a white or whitish light, and that's the state you're in. And Tsongkhapa says that is has a lot of emptiness and just a little bit of bliss. And then the next one you go to is radiance, like sunlight. And Tsongkhapa says it's a lot of bliss and just a little bit of emptiness, right? And then you go to the state of immanence or near achievement, near attainment, where Tsongkhapa says you've got equal amounts of emptiness and bliss. And then, and remember, this is just how we perceive it against the quantum state. And then, according to the teachings, you faint, you see a dark, utter darkness. You don't really see it, you are it. The utter darkness, and then you faint, and then you emerge in clear light, which again, some teachers say, you know, if you're a beginner, just think of it as space. But here's another way to think about it. Think about it in terms of just this quantum state. It's everything. It's absolutely infused with everything, but it's not observed. And therefore, it's not coalesced. It's not crystalline. And then I understand Ling Rinpoche used to stay in that state for a few hours. I stay in that state for about 2 seconds, my daily sadhana. But then what happens is, in the sadhana it says, and then my mind emerges as a squiggle. And then the elements, the wind mandala bow shaped, then fire, then water, then earth, then all of the different realms up to the highest level of form realm. But let's not get there yet. So I was thinking about it. And so here you are, and you're in this kind of quantum state, undifferentiated, and then your mind appears. But does your mind just pop up from a nothingness? No. Your
it
mind
like a fish jumping out of a clear stream.
Like a fish jumping out of a clear stream, but
what they say, but it isn't disappearing as if it's happening automatically. It's your own impulse. Your own compassion impulse.
Right. Right. And the compassion impulse.
You choose to appear.
Well, you choose to appear. But here, you know, if you think of it as just appearing from nothing, then I'm not sure. There's another way to think about it. It's formed from that quantum state.
It's
not nothing. Absolutely not nothing. But from that potentiality of everything, your mind appears. Now, once your mind appears instantaneously, at the same time, your mind proceeds. And so it's not like your mind just hangs out there, non-perceiving, coming from nothing. No. Your mind was a part of this quantum state, and your mind...
Well, your mind is all of it.
Could be all. Okay. So your mind is there, but instantaneously, your mind perceives the elements of the world around whatever your mind perceives. And so Kapa also says that this is true, that you can't have a mind in isolation from what the mind is cognizing, just like you can't have objects. You can't have objects in a vacuum or separate from the mind. So here is just another way to think about it. Now, another way that this modern science may help us understand things is it may help us understand or give us an analogy, because all of these are analogies, for karma and for reincarnation. They verified that if two, say, particles or entities have been very closely related, even if they end up at other ends of the universe, they stay related. So that the way they talk about this, the physicist, if something has an upspin, and there's an entangled particle, they call it in quantum entanglement. This is where Einstein said God does not play dice with the universe. But they prove this, that if there's a particle even so far away that even at the speed of light, it was so far away that there couldn't be any communication between them. If one particle goes up, the other particle is down, constantly. So I've thought a lot. I teach a course at Columbia about reincarnation. And reincarnation, of course, is a big mystery to all of us. Stevenson did a lot of studies on reincarnation. We have a lot of testimony of people with near-death experiences, etc. But there's a way to explain some of this, and the way to explain it scientifically is that it's some kind of information transfer. In other words, it doesn't have to be a soul that's reincarnated, but somehow there's a child who is born and says, wait, I remember I'm the husband of so-and-so who lives in that village, and we have three children. And then they bring the kid to the village, and everybody's there, and the kid recognizes these people. So one aspect that's difficult for us to understand about reincarnation is, if we don't have a soul in Buddhism, then what's going on? In other words, you're reincarnated, but you ain't you.
Okay.
You're reincarnated, but you ain't you.
But you ain't you even from yesterday.
But there's that you ain't you from yesterday. So there's a continuum. And so there could be an explanation through quantum entanglement, of transfer of information, which could account for reincarnation, which would explain reincarnation phenomena without going the whole hog, so we think, oh yeah, I was this and now I'm that, right? Which is a big hang up we all have. So it's interesting, what Bob mentioned before is exactly right, because what kind of impulse could cause you then to want to come back, right? And if you're, the impulse is, I had a great time in this life, I really want to go back and do some more of that. Well, that's a very grasping kind of impulse. And if that's your impulse, you're probably going to be headed for more grasping, because that was the reason you're coming back. But what kind of impulse could get you back to continue this marvelous creation from we know not where? What kind of impulse could get you back without getting you hung up on yourself? It's others, right? It's benefiting others. So what genius, not only in terms of, you know, what heart, and, you know, just the greatest thing in life, thinking for someone else and experiencing their love for someone else, that kind of compassion. But it's also a way to get you back without baggage. Well, I mentioned this to one of my students. My student said, okay, but can't you also be attached to doing things for others? I said, yeah, I mean, because if I came back like that, I'd say, well, when am I getting my award? So this is one way to think about it. And of course, karma also, you know, what could karma be? If information continues to exist, and if your observation creates things, those things don't go away. And so it could well be that when we change, that there's a transfer of this potentiality, this energy. But of course, the other thing about quantum mechanics, and I'll shorten this up, is it's all about probabilities. It's all about probabilities. In other words, nothing is destined to happen. It's simple probabilities. It's that probability wave. So actually, it's very interesting, because to me, that also says that there are certain events that we cannot understand through science or even logic. Very small possibility of events. That's a whole other topic. But this could explain UFOs, at least some of them.
Wouldn't that imply then that everything is actually real? In other words, the potentiality is also actual in its entirety.
Well, there, you know, they,
all possibilities are real.
There are theories of quantum mechanics, the many worlds theories of Everett, and then the many minds theory of Mensky, Russian, who in fact says that when you experience things, you choose, and then your consciousness divides into many universes, and they all exist. We don't have to, yes, the answer is yes, it could well be. Could be that all these things play out, but here we are in this universe. But in this universe, here, this is a way, just looking at it like this, is a way to realize how much choice and freedom we actually have. That we are entirely free if we can just start wriggling out of our conditioning. Because once we start wriggling out of our conditioning, then through our disciplined observation of us as deities, we create the conditions that we can then use in the perfection stage to go all the way. And it really makes sense scientifically. But when you read all this stuff from the 60s and 70s, and you know, people got all excited about stuff like this. I've never seen it quite like this. And of course we say, well, you know, that was just a bunch of people running around with drugs. Not really. You know, it's so interesting how we can have good ideas and then forget about them. And then they just disappear. So this is another way, and it's so interesting that this is the leading edge of science now. And it's, to my mind, completely consistent with esoteric Buddhism and what we're doing, and says that maybe with real good practice and intense observation, we do create these conditions. We do create the subtle body. And of course, this would also account for why there are so many different practices, because this practice could work and that practice could work. If you have 16 channels in the throat or 17 channels in the throat, they both may work if you create those conditions. But of course, we have testimony, and we have the Tibetan civilization, where the whole civilization created conditions for people to go to the cave and do this. And so therefore, if we have good testimony from people who seem that they're not fooling with us, that these things work, we're given a great path. But it's no longer a woo-woo. It really does make sense.
That's great. Thank you. You want to put the dialogue a little?
Sure, let's dialogue.
Okay, I had a question maybe here.
Yeah, Dan.
I think I prefer the word bodhisattva rather than become a deity, because bodhisattva is more a certain a people. Deity has got these connotations of worshipping. And a bodhisattva vow is to not gain a nirvana or total bliss until every blade of grass is nirvana. So I just feel that the bodhisattva vow is the hook. What you're saying.
Yeah, absolutely. Because what being Diana was saying, that the bodhisattva vow is really the hook for everything.
Oh yes, yes.
And it is, because we are beings who love from the very instant we're born. So we just need the best kind of we gotta do the best kind of love we can. That's our strong suit. And how amazing that we have the bodhisattva ideal that is love to the nth degree, mm-hmm. without selfishness.
Even him.
Yeah.
So that's the thing. For quantum, they don't feel that the quantum tone is love. You know? But I think the Buddhist view would be that clear light is love.
Yeah.
And you know, so I want to come back to you, this thing about your 108th thing, if I might, in this following sense, that it seems to be, I just want to ask you a question, it seems to be that you have 10 winds. And can you remind me, I've forgotten actually, okay, the prana wind is located in the brain and goes from the brain to the heart primarily, or basically, like medically that's the case. The ascending wind comes from the heart and rises to the throat chakra. The metabolic wind basically deals with digestion, it's just sort of the area of the navel chakra and the heat of the stomach and digestion and so on. The evacuative wind hangs out in the intestine and the colon and it helps eliminate the waste, right? And the pervading wind does function as the motor wind. But when you said it doesn't act until death, it doesn't get into the central channel until death, is what I mean. So you can't withdraw the pervading wind from the motor muscles until death. But it is functioning, that's how you move your arm, is the pervading wind.
Yeah.
Right? And then, yeah, I don't remember, there's the per moving, the moving, and one of those five winds, the five branch winds, connects to the eye sense, one connects to the ear sense. I don't remember which is which. And they sort of come out of the heart chakra.
Mm-hmm.
something, mm-hmm. basically, mm-hmm. right? And they go to the different five senses. So that means one of them goes to all your skin, all your body surfaces, right? The one that goes to the touch sense. So then this 108 seems to be that these are different names for the same winds in the different, when they're in the different complexes. And that must be when they're going out of the complexes. And then they're associating them with different kinds of mental functions, right? But aren't they making the mental functions goddesses? But the overwhelming, when you call it overwhelming, it's seeing those mental functions as goddesses. I don't see the list of goddesses. I thought there were goddesses.
No, they are later on.
There's 108 goddesses, right?
There's a list of goddesses, and I don't remember if there are 108 of them. I think there are the chakra goddesses. Right, and that would be right. That would be visualizing them as goddesses.
For example, in Kala Chakra, there's the 64 speech goddesses.
Yeah.
And they actually end up in the 64 petals of the navel chakra. And they're lounging around there right now. Each one has, we have 64 divine ladies in the navel chakra, mm-hmm. each of us. Mm-hmm. So they seem to replicate
themselves. We gotta wake them up.
I think they are.
See, one of these are, you know, maybe that's right. Maybe this is where they move out, because Tsongkhapa says, and commenting on the commentary on this text, mm-hmm. that what it is there are nine winds in every channel. In every chakra.
Yeah.
9 times 6 is 54, right. 54 in the day and 54 in the night makes 108. And that, so they're moving at different times of the day and night. And it could be, Bob, what you say is correct. I haven't seen it in the commentary, but this is why it's really helpful to know all the different tantric systems and the commentary. And this is why figuring this out is so collective. And this is why we all have to help each other. You know, maybe some of you in your practice have, you know, come across things that relate to this, because it could be that some of these things were taken for granted 1,000 years ago. They were known, and now we're trying to put them back together. So Bob, maybe that's right. Maybe they are coming out from the different channels.
If the sexualities are functioning,
then
that's because those winds are subdividing in the different levels, the main 10 winds. And then when they come out, they associate with the conceptuality, meaning some thought that you have. And some of them are negative, deceit and being horrible and like that. And then I think the overcoming is that when you give up your own identifying with the thought, and then goddesses move in and help you by controlling your wills. And so the old, what was negative, is turned by them into something useful, and then they bring it back into the central channel, something like that.
And
it has to be.
Yeah, and I wonder about the practice. You know, like last night, for some reason, about 9 o'clock at night, I got anxious. About 9 o'clock at night, I got anxious. Uh-oh. I got anxious.
Uh-oh.
So I thought to myself, you know, according to the Vajramala, there's some wind in one of my chakras making me feel like this.
Yeah.
Now, if I knew exactly where it was, then I could concentrate on it, I could identify it, and then through deity yoga, identify the goddess, and then if I really had my stuff together, I'd know how to bring those winds into my central channel and keep my awareness, and I wouldn't be anxious anymore.
Mm-hmm. Where you could transform.
You could transform it.
I could transform it. And this is one, this system, which has been lost, it might not have been lost, it might be just lost to me. You know,
maybe you can't transform it. This is one of the things. Maybe you have to give it up to the goddesses and let them transform it for you. Is what I'm trying to get at. In other words, there's quantum foam, but you know there's other beings over many millennia,
you know, infinite past time, who have already mastered all this stuff. And they're still present. And there are all these dakinis and yoginis, you know, who are micro yoginis. And they might come and they might see your wind sneaking off in your navel chakra and creating and about to reflect an anxiety on you, a horrible anxiety. And then if you're sort of open to them, if you've made your peace with them, then they will themselves, okay, come on, you know, like that naughty thought, like, oh, make a horrible on him, and go back and go back and give him a blissed essential channel instead.
Right. So how do we, so how do
maybe
we, do,
I'm
so how,
thinking, I'm
right,
thinking out loud.
I know, I'm saying, I'm thinking too,
know.
You know, so, you know, there are many techniques in the tantras about doing this, and the Vajramala actually talks about, you know, mantra and bringing the winds into the central channel and overcoming these things. Yeah, absolutely. Grace for sure.
So how do you mentioned at one point that this 108 thing is very important in the context of Vajra Japa, the Vajra murmuring, you know, which is the speech stage of the perfection stage.
Yeah.
And of course, the ultimate Vajra murmuring is where you no longer go Om Mahabhuvaham Samarayaham Pe or Om Mahabhadrakaham Pe, but you just inhale and it's Om, and you hold the breath and it's Ah, and you exhale and it's Hum. So you go Om Ah Hum. So somehow you're unifying all these 108 winds, everything into body, speech, and mind of all Buddhas. And your breathing, your very breathing is the body, speech, and mind. And then you can do, and then I don't know well, but this must be connected to when you breathe there's a sets of 225 breaths. And sets of
yeah.
multiplied by four,
yeah.
900 breaths.
Right.
And one set of 225 is the earth
yeah.
breath of Mochana.
Right.
And one is the
water
breath of
Tara,
the
yeah.
fire
yeah.
breath of Pandara
yeah.
and the
mm-hmm.
and the wind breath of Tara. And that these go in different parts of your nostril.
Yeah, that is
up,
the,
down, and both.
The text for that is chapter 12 of the Vajramala.
Okay, yeah.
That's the foundational text
yeah.
for that practice.
Okay.
Is that also is that kind of a pan tantric practice?
Yeah,
that
yeah,
practice.
And then, right. but then somehow that does connect to roping in. Those are the main Buddhas, female Buddhas. Who have as a retinue all like 108 goddesses or different systems, 32 goddesses in the Vajra Yogini system that are just in the petals of your heart chakra.
Yeah.
64 goddesses in the Kapha chakra system,
mm-hmm.
particularly, but then there's even more than that because there are female Buddhas in the other chakras, but there's just 64 in the navel chakra. So I don't know, but I just wanted to.
Well,
hold
on one second,
yeah.
in the Vajramala, it's chapter 6. There are two mantras. There's Om Ahom, which is later on,
yeah.
which is described in the Vajramala, how you do it, what you're doing with it. And then there's also a different schema of Hum Ho, which involves inhaling to the heart and then exhaling through the wind chakra, Vishnusha here. And they're both methods for doing the same thing.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
But it's interesting. The
I thought Hum Ho was when you're moving around more, when you're out in the room.
Same thing. In fact, and then it's really quite. It's a very long text, and it's interesting because you're talking about the goddesses. The first chapter is the introduction, where there are 81 questions asked of Vajradhara.
Okay.
And Vajradhara says, you know, I'm going to answer all of these. And then the next chapter is about initiation. And it has to do with, you know, higher tantric initiation, which is all about goddesses. And then you go into the taxonomy of these 108 winds and conceptualities. They're all named. 108 winds, 108 conceptualities. And then you go into a chapter about emptiness. Because, of course, emptiness is key in all of these practices. If you think you're grasping onto something, you're not doing it. Like Bob just said to me, be open to those goddesses. It's not a question of your overcoming. I love that. It's a question of being open
right.
and letting that happen.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Can I make a footnote about the quantum thing?
because I don't know, I guess I didn't tell you about my, the lecture I heard from Henry Stapp. Did I tell you about it? So it was at Deepak's place. And Henry Stapp is in the Santa Fe Institute, it's one of those kind of, and you can see him, he's just a really eminent one of that. And I had never heard of him, and I found his book, but I hadn't thought to read it. Anyway, what he said was so, it helped me so much. And I said, you could feel the validity of it. And that was that when Bohr and Heisenberg came up with the uncertainty principle and announced it at the Copenhagen conference with Einstein and everybody there, they not only said this thing about, things only exist when you observe them and then you're working with probabilities and this sort of thing. That was what they were all kind of into that. But that was their consolation or their compensation for the main announcement, which was that when you get to a certain degree of microverse, you know, a certain degree of tininess, that you get into that place where the mind disturbs the observation, and then that's what you said, the momentum and the position you cannot determine. So in fact, the concept of there being an objective reality is destroyed. And the subjective is entwined with it. Why? So the subjectivity of the observation interferes with the thing being standing there, sort of, this is it, it's in that place. You follow?
Yeah, but there's only one thing that you said. It wasn't that there's any kind of physical disturbance by mind or brain waves,
no.
But the interaction itself, the observation itself.
Yeah, but that's the mind observing.
Right.
So you're subjectivity.
Because at one point, one of them, I forget who, said there could be something about, at a very subtle level, something about the observation, the photons, whatever it is,
yeah,
that are actually disturbing and changing. That was proved to be not true. It's simply,
Wait, let me finish what I'm saying about. And so the point is, they said that's where probability became important.
Right.
Because they said you can't pin it down at the absolute micro level because your subjectivity is involved. And therefore, it's not like it's standing out there, you can organize it and come up with a theory that corresponds to it. That was the main point. And that's where Einstein led a rebellion, according to Stapp. He completely wouldn't accept that. And he said, that's where he said the famous God does not play dice.
Right.
In other words, he would not surrender the control, the dream of control, ultimate mental and conceptual control. He wanted his conceptualities to keep functioning, the horrible, the flesh piercing. He wanted them all to work and under his control.
Yeah.
And Bohr and Heisenberg said, well, sorry, guys, you can't do that. But they tried to console him, saying, no, but you can do a lot of stuff. You can make quantum computers, you can blow up the world, you can do whatever you like, on the probability.
Right.
Without having to absolute certainty about it. You can still do a lot with probability. And then the idea that somebody might have said, and you might have read, that they disprove that there is no, it's all solid all the way down, that according to Stapp's explanation, the people who rebelled were constantly coming up with things that they proved this and that didn't happen. But with 11 dimensions and all these other things that they come up with, like Brian Greene does, it's all settled and set solid at the 11th dimension. Of course, we can't reach the 11th dimension. It's all solid with the dark matter, the dark energy. Of course, we haven't seen that yet. So in other words, what Stapp said was that the guys who could surrender control and who worked experimentally making things and doing all these things, as you mentioned earlier, that we depend on, they were the guys who really sort of ultimately they were ready to work in conventionality. The guys like Einstein, and he, because he was Einstein, he led a huge cohort of people who were still, grand unified theory, we're going to get there, we're going to get it.
Yeah.
They're full of shit, he said.
Well, the whole notion of a unified theory is a really interesting one. Why does there have to be a unified theory?
To keep control.
No, I know. No. But why? But otherwise, we keep working toward a theory of everything. We want to unify quantum gravity and quantum mechanics, et cetera, et cetera. But just thinking about it, why does there have to be a theory of everything? Why should there be one theory that explains everything? Why? Do you know? That's the Holy Grail, and I think Bob's right. I think it has to do with our human desire to control, grasp, and have it. But why can't there be different theories for different things, at least conceptually.
Yeah, well, so anyway, that helped me a lot. That's what I mentioned. The idea that the mind, in a way, that was the proof that mind is a force in nature. You know, because they didn't want to accept, you know, they wanted absolute objectivity. And even today, you know, even Higgs boson experiment, you know, you can just commonsensically kind of chuckle when they announce in the newspaper that they discovered the secret of mass. And I wanted to tell another little incident that pertains to this. You know, Evan Thompson, who was also Bill Thompson's son, who was my student at Amherst, an NBC philosopher, you know, goes to mind that life all the time. He's in Toronto. He's a Canadian originally. And he was saying to Dalai Lama, trying to be nice, when there was a quantum guy and a neuroscientist. And the quantum guy was saying, look, we don't have a theory. We don't know what's going on. He was a Nobel Prize quantum guy from Austria, I forget his name. But he was the most open. He was saying, because he was on the Bohr and Heisenberg side, he was saying, we don't know what's going on. We work just that we muddle around as best we can and make a lot of stuff, but we don't know. So we need a theory from you, Your Holiness, he was saying. And the neuroscience guy was pushing, we know what's going on. And you know, it was like that. So then Evan Thompson says to Dalai Lama, oh, Your Holiness, you insist that mind is not material. You know, maybe information, some stuff. But you know, how can we work on? We're going to work on trying to figure out how a non-material thing matters. You know, how can it influence matter? So we're going to work on that, but it's really hard for us. We can't figure it out. So what happened to me even like 6 weeks ago? I was thinking about in your case, about the wind energy thing, whether we should just say energy. And I was looking into the etymology of the word energy from Greek and whether it actually relates to motion. Because wind is not a breeze. That's not wind. Wind is pure motion. The fact that this makes an impact on my chi is because there's an earth component in it, there's a water, there's moisture in it, there's warmth in it, right? So they're always connected to each other. They're just abstractions. So I was wondering if energy was like, look, I discovered, which of course I should know, E equals MC squared. Energy has no mass. So energy doesn't matter either. Because I know when those guys were, when he was saying that, all those scientists, except the quantum guy, because they're all in the 19th century where there's the hard tables and hard matter, and they had it in their mind, this billiard ball thing, where something that isn't a billiard ball makes the billiard ball move. That can't be. The mind can't be involved in nature and making billiard balls bang into each other.
Well, it's making my arm move up right now.
Exactly. But the point is, your energy has no mass. So how in the hell does it make your arm move? Is it, if it gets mass when it's multiplied twice the speed of light squared? It's a really high number. So you mean when I move my arm, the energy of my arm suddenly multiplies the speed of light by square?
Yeah,
it's a total bunch of theology.
It is, and Feynman, the great Richard Feynman, his famous quote is that anybody who says they understand quantum mechanics is lying.
What?
He says anyone who understands quantum mechanics is lying. No one understands it. No, it's unbelievable. This is the theory of matter. And nobody gets it. Actually, what happened was, Bob's right, you know, after they disagreed about philosophically what it was, then they said, okay, we'll agree to disagree, and now let's just make things work. And so they've been concentrating. But now, over the past 15 years, people are getting back to trying to figure out philosophically what it means.
You know, Glashow, for example, even, you know, bless his heart, Brian Green, my former, you know, building mate, you know, he admits in his show, you know, The Quantum Cafe, he does go and interview Sheldon Glashow, who says, your 12, 11 dimensions and all that is a bunch of BS, because there's no experiment that can prove or falsify. So it's pure theory.
It's just what they say about religion, that it can't be proved, right?
So, Brian, in the string theory, even people, they are they're following the Einstein rebellion against uncertainty. And against the sort of idea that we have to surf reality. You know?
we can't control it. You can't control that wave and make it push you and win a championship on the north coast of Oahu and not get crashed into the waves. You can't. You just can only figure out how to fit with it. You know, fit with it, not control.
Well, the amazing thing is that we have this tradition that we're studying that is the subjective tradition, where mm-hmm. we have testimony and learning from people who have gone within and really concentrated and talk about the effects. So that's open to us to do.
So this then we come to like where I left the class at the Tibet House on Wednesday. We come to the inconceivable liberation. To understand the inconceivable liberation, you have to understand taking a plant and putting it into a mustard seed. Without making the mustard seed any bigger, or the planet any smaller. And the beings on the planet don't know they're being put in a mustard seed, except for a few who have kind of clairvoyance. Otherwise, they're just going about their business, they're still spinning around the sun. You know, they even say you take a galaxy and you fling it across the universe like a frisbee. And then you bring it back and put it where it was, and nobody knows they were flung across the universe. So what that is trying to say, I think, is that when you get to be clear light, when you go past immanence and you get to clear light, that you are the infinite form. And from the fact that your mind has merged with all of it is a blissful condition. And you don't need to come back, actually, there's no gravity. Except you have a bodhisattva vow. That you, the momentum of your loving and compassionate connection to other beings who are not enjoying floating in the quantum form, as the quantum. Right? So, but that's not a theory almost. It's like a faith, as you said. It's like a knowledge that it's a faith.
You know, but the theory is that faith is effective. In other words, faith is a kind of witnessing. Faith is a kind of observation.
Yes.
And so who knows? It could be that in the minutes of death, mm-hmm. you know, which may turn into an eternity from a subjective point of view, it could be an eternity. Okay. It could be that the devout Christian will experience heaven.
Heaven.
Could be.
Well,
or someone who dies with lots on their mind may go to a really bad place.
Oh, yeah.
So if observation is creating at least the perceived reality, you know, and once our conditioning that binds us all together as we are dying and our senses are falling away gets weaker and weaker. Yeah. So we're just left with that crap inside our heads. Right, then that becomes they say we become 9 times more intelligent as we die, but maybe what it is consciousness becomes that much more powerful. So who knows? But at least it's really interesting that modern science does not contradict these practices. I can't say I don't know enough to say that it supports it. But it doesn't contradict it.
Okay, now let's hear something from Kundalini.
There's so many cool points that come up on this, right?
Yeah.
The first one that jumps to mind is the Heart Sutra, right? Because if you understand E equals MC squared, this is actually telling you E equals MC squared.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Matter is voidness. Voidness is matter. Voidness is not different from matter,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So voidness, quantum energy. Matter is literally made out of quantum energy, right? The E equals MC squared. The whole secret to it is that you take matter, particularly extremely dense matter like uranium, and then you create fission, right? And the matter changes into energy, but it's the speed of light, you know, squared. Is a huge release of energy when you change matter when you release it.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. Sure.
The opposite is true, right? So for instance, in Star Trek, you have the replicators.
Yeah.
Right? Where you make your food. The idea is that that's energy, right, from these unbelievably powerful, you know,
dilithium crystals.
Dilithium crystals. So you're taking. But this is real stuff, because this is why the race is on for fusion reaction.
Yeah.
If you have unlimited energy,
yes,
you can then create it directly into matter, right? You have to have a ton of energy, but you literally will create matter. So again, matter is voidness. Voidness is matter. Voidness is not different from matter. This is literally E equals MC squared, but 2,500 years ago. Right?
Let me ask you a question on about that. You know, I'm thinking about what you said. You know, if what I was thinking was that, you know, observation can create the world the way it is. Now, in one respect, we know that, because we know that our state of mind affects what we see. But then I'm thinking about, you know, Scotty, turn up the engines, I need a cup of coffee. Could we, is it foolish to think that mental power could have such vast amounts of energy that it could affect matter?
Yes.
Why is that foolish?
I don't know, I'm just thinking.
It's not foolish. In fact, it's been suggested already. Now, the link Bob earlier was talking about the schism between the neurologist, right, and the quantum mechanics.
Yeah.
We already have a connecting theory, right? It was produced in the 1930s by Carl S. Jung and the Nobel Prize winning quantum theorist, Wolfgang Pauli, who suggested that part of the observer, Wolfgang Pauli, P-A-U-L-I.
Oh, yeah, right. Right.
So they suggested that there is a connection between human consciousness and at a particular frequency, an in-between level, dream state, vision state, that appears to have a quantum effect on reality. And they called it the psychophysical, right? This is the term that they come up with. But the whole idea, this is why Wolfgang Pauli was involved in the research, as a quantum theorist, is that there is some strange connection, not at sort of like the conscious level that we're operating right now, but at an in-between state between consciousness and unconsciousness, which is dream state, right, and also visionary state, that then seems to have a weird aspect on reality as far as what happens, right? So the classic example is the white bird. So Jung had a number of patients who would have recurring dreams. And these dreams, for some reason, seemed to have a great deal of psychic weight to them, the deep resonance for the patient. Often it really disturbed the patient, and for reasons that the patient didn't know. So the classic example is that one of these patients is in his office in Switzerland, right, lying on the couch, telling Jung about this dream that they've had for years, about a white bird that then, you know, flies down in the dream, lands on the windowsill of the patient's bedroom, and stares at the patient. And something about that, for the patient, was deeply disturbing, right? So they remembered it. So this guy is literally lying here, telling Jung this, and then Jung hears a flutter of wings. And he looks to the side, and here's the open window of his office, and a white bird flutters down, lands on the windowsill, and stares at him. Right?
Really?
Yes, yes. This is the first time that Jung came up with this, or experienced this. So, you know, of course, if that happened, you'd be like, oh, it's a coincidence.
Yeah.
It's no big deal. So another big case was the red fox, and Jung was walking in the countryside with a long-time female patient of his. Patient is telling him about this recurring dream that she's having, in which she's walking in the countryside, and she becomes aware that on the other side of the hedgerow, there's a fox, and the fox is walking at the same pace she is, and looks at her, right? And again, something about this really disturbed her. There's something archetypal going on, something deep in the unconscious mind that gave this weight to her, right? So, as she's talking to Jung, they both become aware that on the other side of the hedgerow is a red fox that's walking at the same pace as them, turns and looks at them, eventually moves forward, crosses the road in front of them, staring at them, and then disappears into the fog. So this type of thing shows up a lot with Jung. So Jung suggests, and this is weird.
So then how does Wolfgang Pauli get involved in that? In other words, Jung is discovering some materialization of fantasies or dreams.
Yeah.
And then where does Pauli like fit with that?
I don't know how they initially got into it, but you know, together they developed this idea that we're now very familiar with, of synchronicity.
Uh-huh.
Right? So a synchronicity is defined by Jung and Pauli as an acausal event, right, that has great significance for the observer and often can only be identified by the observer that's having the experience. So a classic example is, and this happens to us all the time, right? So say you wake up and you turn on your computer's there and you turn it on and there's a commercial for a red Jeep, okay? So then you have breakfast, you're driving to work, and you see a crashed red Jeep by the side of the road. You're like, oh, that's weird, that's two Jeeps. Right. And so then you go to work, and there's a red Jeep on the magazine cover in your cubicle, you know? And then, that's a very simple synchronicity, right? But it's a weird connection. It's particularly weird if, it appears within dreams, visions, and we experience this all the time, which suggests that there is some connection not just on space-time, but something more like fate.
Fate?
Fate, yes.
Not fate, fate.
Right, fate.
Okay.
Right? So again, this stuff where you, and I think we probably all experienced this, where something sticks in your head, and or this happened to me here. This happens to me all the time.
No, that's true.
Anyway,
but it reminds me of another story about a Dalai story, which is what's another Joseph?
Can you raise the next question?
Oh, okay. Well, I just wanted to tell a Dalai story. There was a quantum physicist in Naples who was telling a Dalai about this kind of things. You know, about the thing about two particles occupying the same space, and then splitting apart with no cause, acausally, because your acausally thing made me think about. And he was saying how we have to sort of cope with these kind of counterintuitive things. And a lot of what he was doing. And Donald was being very polite, listening, and it was on closed circuit TV, and about 5,000 geishas were also listening, Tibetan scholars, professors. And the idea of an uncaused phenomenon is completely anathema in sort of conventional Buddhist thinking. And so at the end of it, then the guy felt he was losing his audience. It was art science, actually. He felt he was losing the audience. He kind of felt a little uncomfortable. And there was two of them. There were two quantum events. So he sort of threw it at the end, knowing to make his audience happy. He said, and you know, if we really get to figure this out, all these completely impossible, amazing thing, we can connect it with ethics, and we'll get a new ethics based on quantum reasoning. So the Dalai Lama looks up and he says, you know, if you can do that, he said, I'm going to give you a scientist guru hat. And there's big laughter, everybody's laughing because they know that. It just really makes no sense, I think. So the quantum physicist is feeling a little uncomfortable, but they're being good sports, and they're laughing, and everybody's roaring with laughter. So then the laughter quiets down, then Donna says, and you know, he says, those hats will have a lot of holes in them. It's hot weather in South India, Karnataka, triple. So they're thinking like an Australian hat with the ventilation things, they're sort of having, they're kind of visualizing this hat, like a scientist guru's hat. And then after finally dies down, and then the Dalai Lama works up all his courage, his gentleness and politeness, and he kind of leans forward and he says, to go along with all the holes in your theory. place completely tanks up, and they're laughing, but they're a little freaked out. So then it quiets down, and then it's all over. He gets up and gives them like a $500,000 check to carry on with their work. And then he approaches them like a waiter in a Chinese restaurant. He says, "Oh, sorry, just teasing. And then he asks his attendant, you know, to come up and gives him his little briefcase, and he hands him a check for $500,000 that somebody gave him. You know, that
he Do you think
up.
He had the check made out before he said all those things?
Yeah.
In that amount?
Yeah, I think so.
Well, so I guess he figured it was okay.
And anyway, you know, I don't know about synchronicity, but now coming back to these 180 yogis, though, you know, in the Kala Chakra, there's this picture that I haven't shared with everybody because we haven't got the projector for it, but it's a picture of Kala Chakra in the Great Bliss Mandala with the 8 Shaktis around. And then there's 2 more Shaktis who are merged with him and with Vishwamata. You know, he's standing there. And then these 8 Shaktis are around there, each one with 8 arms and 4 faces. You know. And those are the 10 winds. But they're just in the, they could be in the heart chakra, or they could be just you in the talus, or whatever it is. It sort of fit at all levels. And somehow, it's more simple. It's like they've combined in that. And like the Hum Ho, or the Om Ah Hum of the Vajracchapa, sort of draws them all together. But, the, you know, like in the Vajracchapa, they have the 100 deity version, they have the 5 deity version, they have the 1 deity version. So the key point is all of them are the releasing the elements of life and allowing the blessed enlightened Dakinis and the mother beings, you know, to welcome them into something good. And coming into your central channel, and you know, creating bliss rather than horrible things and so on. So this must be a version of that for some types of very complex, psychologically sophisticated people who are mindfully aware of the minor little flicks of the mind, like a little flick of deception, a little flick of hypocrisy, a little flick of pretension, a little flick of anger, irritation, of revulsion, you know, all kind of little...
Sure, it's what it is, because it's pretty clear that there are 2 stages. And the first stage is to identify them.
Uh-huh, right.
First identify, and then overcome. And in fact, the process...
By identifying them with some divinity.
Well, and then by letting the vitality wind, you know, overcome them, the wisdom wind, as they call it.
Right, then you're right.
Right. So, so it's... It is like that. And
but
it could be that some of these in Kala Chakra, since it's later.
I don't think, you know, he told Kala Chakra how he was teaching Pada Pandita in another place.
Same thing, taught them all the same.
Yeah, you know, we can't say that. Well, we can, actually. Because why? If you come to the view that this area of the uncertainty and of inconceivability at the super micro level cannot be kind of control from the outside, like as if it was a bunch of objective things to be manipulated around, but actually can be merged with by an alert and enlightened subjectivity, which becomes all of those things, and sort of can masters them by being them, actually, and can redirect them in a positive way. If a human being has the capability to do that, and not just a human being, maybe a deity, maybe other being, then that those beings could have done things like simultaneously taught in 2 bodies in 1 place, or done all these things. I mean, it creates a completely different view of life that emerges from that possibility. And even the problem, I guess, being they themselves say that you can't sort of prove that in a kind of dualistic, logical way. So at some point, they should say that. But on the other hand, I'm not sure about that either. That's why I love the 4 points. Remember the 4 points that Daniel told me? It just blew my mind, but I never heard of it. It says, you know, you see nothing. That should make him happy, the scientist. Okay, it's all nothing. You see, that's what you see. Okay. You know emptiness. That's what you know. And how do you know emptiness? By inference, actually. By reason of relativity. You don't see emptiness. as an object. If you see as an empty thing, a space, that's a fake thing, that's not seeing emptiness. Because emptiness is matter. So you can't see emptiness as a separated thing. But you know it. And you can only know it by inference. Because the inference is the relativity of everything. So that is the emptiness is actually
through
the relativity.
You know it through reason.
Yeah, from reason. So that's the last place where you know something. Then you experience bliss, which you're not knowing nothing, you're giving it up, right? And then, but then this is the weird thing. So you merge with it all by bliss, right? But then, you can do it in a sadhana in the form of deciding to reappear as a squiggle initially, the most minimalist thing you can think of. Maybe it's a string, top down of somebody's string theory. It's a little squiggle, I topped it up. But you assert, I am clear light. I am Shunyatanya Vajra Svabhava Atma Koham.
You know, the thing is that you could know emptiness, and it might never occur to you that you should, as a result of that, experience bliss.
It wouldn't occur to you?
It might not.
Why not?
If you were a Heidegger, for instance, and you didn't know about compassion, and you were an intellectual type, and so you reasoned, and you came to the conclusion of emptiness, you inferred that, then it might not experience, you might not experience that as blissful. But then, if someone says to you, that is blissful, then you start to think about it. Whoa, wait, that's bliss? And then, maybe, you start to experience it as bliss.
Well, that is an objection that comes. But I don't agree with that because of the following. Yeah. When you die, you know, we do have the experimental evidence that when people die from near-death experience types, that they, and then for some reason they come, they revive. They don't want to necessarily come back because they're giving it up of the stress of being like a constructed body in a world of pressures is the release of that. That's what bliss is.
Unless that's
what is orgasm.
Unless you know the counter to that is that at death neurochemicals are released that cause people to experience that bliss. So that's what they. So that's what the.
Yeah, but they're not being released because they're already in a body bag. There are some of the near-death experience people have already been put in a morgue in a body bag.
No, but they still have consciousness. You know, in one of my classes we had.
Well, no, there's no movement in the brain, so they shouldn't be able to have consciousness. The brain, they've already been, you know, diagnosed with.
But listen,
what happens at the very beginning of the Vajra?
The very beginning, Buddha teaches,
and what happened?
And the bodhisattvas listen, and they're so, and then Buddha emanates from his own vajra, a consort. And at first Buddha appears without any color. And then he emanates his girlfriend. And then all the bodhisattvas look at that, and they faint.
They pass out.
Well. Well, yeah, sorry. Later. But we had in one of my classes, we have little discussion groups, and one of the students was a hospice nurse, and Karen had been a hospice nurse for 20 years, and before that she was an emergency room nurse. And so it came out that we were talking about this, and Karen was sitting right there. She tells the students in the little group, she says, you know, 6 or 7 times I was there in the emergency room or with hospice, flatlined, and then the patient revived and described what was happening in the room when she was flatlined. No, from a different perspective. From a different perspective, you know, in the room, which is common, but you know, the impact of someone saying it. It's one thing you read in one of these books, it comes from the 60s or 70s, or you know, a seminar, and they say this and that, you know, but it's another thing when you have just a regular person, really down to earth, describing this. that really blew everyone away. So Dawkins, the Dawkins of all people, Richard Dawkins, who you debated, he has something that's a little bit offensive, but I think it's true, even though it's offensive. He says, it's like we're all wearing burkas. We see so little of what,
well, that's because he is trying to explain it away.
Yeah. No, he says, I think he's right there. He says, because our perceptions are so limited,
yeah.
And you could say they're so limited by our conditioning. I think I'm more like him, actually. But anyway, so he says, we just see.
I have a slight view for Dawkins because he accepted my challenge to a debate about reincarnation at the Stanford Aurora Forum. And then he never would give them a date. And then the manager of the forum.
Did he have a debate at 96th Street?
What?
Didn't you and Dawkins have a debate on 96th
he never
Street?
Accepted.
He never came?
It was never scheduled. He will never. He keeps saying, yeah, I'll debate with Thurman, but then he never shows up. He never said. But that's okay. I'm just kidding. All I'm saying is that, if scientists were really being scientists instead of a bunch of dogmatic high priests, this idea that there might be a possibility of the mind itself of a being entering a merger with the super micro state, and therefore then really being able to move energy and mass, at will, that they should do an experiment in the sense of they should create a funded institute of yogis who are trained in all of this, and who then they put all machinery on them, and they put them in this and that thing, and chambers and magnetic resonance, and let them do it. And in a way, David said those guys with a little bit of mindfulness, a little bit of compassion, you got throwing Matthew Ricard and that thing. They're sort of starting there, but he has to also have animals, killing animals to get the, endocrine things and make things for drugs for companies, because they won't really support him that strongly to do that. So he's trying to do that, Davidson, but nobody's really doing it full scale. Go find, go get 50 geishas from Brigham and then Sarah and then support them to really, and then really examine them, what they do. They're not doing that. And they're not even translating the books that train them to do that. That's a translation thing. Then they would fund the translation if they thought that should be an experiment, but they won't. Even Davidson, I just want to finish my gripe. Even Davidson, who gets this data in his thing about somebody meditating compassion and that, he won't ask any of his funders for a grant to translate the books that Matthew Ricard studied. And he doesn't ask Matthew Ricard or the Dalai Lama, what did they study that makes him make this change when he meditates compassion? They will not look at the software because of their intellectual arrogance. They won't do it. And they're also closure in their fear. So that's my complaint. So faith rules it out, But faith is enough for us.
Faith, very powerful. Very powerful. The most compassionate people you see, I think, are the people who work in hospitals.
Yes.
Taking care of the patients, and usually, at least in New York, they come from somewhere in the Caribbean. It takes them 3 hours to get to work on a subway. They're supporting, family at home, and they're nobody's fools. Nobody's fools, and they have such deep faith in Jesus at the same time. It's really amazing.
That's true.
The nurse's aides in those hospitals.
Yeah,
all
exactly. Right.
And when Nina was in the hospital when she was paralyzed for a year, the Lodger of the chain gave me some rituals to do because he said she was cursed by somebody, some sorcery was involved. And other lamas thought she would just die, and everybody would die. And even Dalai Lama admitted he thought she would die later. And they were giving me a real hassle about staying in the room, past hours and all this kind of thing, all the nurses, they were. Then one rabbi got sick, and he was in a corner room, and he had five disciples davening outside his door day and night. Then they stopped hassling me. And then the ritual.
Is the rabbi okay?
What?
Is the rabbi okay?
I hope so. I don't know. But then I started doing this ritual, which involved making a little thing with a peacock feather and some flour, and then you get the flour and you put it on parts of the body of the person, and then you throw it out in the waste, the toxic waste. And those voodoo oriented nurses saw me doing that, and they started taking care of it. Oh, did they ever? They were really cool.
jump in.
So I think we go to dinner now. So thank you, David.
Wait, you have a question? Oh, Diana has a question.
Oh, is there more questions? Oh, yeah, another question from
sorry,
Diana.
Sorry,
it's
on.
She's got it. Yeah, that's good.
No, it's
on.
Now she turned it off.
Oh, on top.
It's on.
Euthanasia, Switzerland. Isn't that a right place to people to volunteer to go through the death process? Would they be happy to do that? You know, if scientists want to put electrodes and see exactly what happens to the brain and then dissect the brain afterwards, aren't these people that voluntarily take themselves to Switzerland for euthanasia, wouldn't they be a right audience for this? Volunteer, not audience, because they're not going to come back.
Here, repeat it for me.
People who are due to be euthanized,
oh,
wouldn't they make a good receptive audience for being monitored as they die, type of thing, and then oh, have their brains dissected and evaluated, right?
Well, His Holiness has thought about that. And Richard Davidson and that Wolf Singer, who's the neuroscientist in Germany, they bought, or whatever, they got funding, and they have a portable fMRI machine in Mumbai, in a locker.
Yeah.
And they're going to, when they hear that someone is dying, who has the ability to do what they call sitting in clear light, where the body will sit for a few days or a few weeks without rotting and falling over, and they're not breathing and they're flatlined, etc. Yet they sit perfectly okay for a while. The Dalai Lama is worried that they won't get there in time with all the flights and the whole thing and the buses and things. So he said, he asked at one of the conferences, he said, do you think it's okay if I ask them to pre-schedule?
Well, I guess that's my point, is that Switzerland is already set up. That the person is there, they know exactly the time and date they're going to get the lethal injection, and they could have all the equipment. Switzerland's got all the equipment and the funding.
Well, that's true, but then a normal person who's doing euthanasia, who's because they're depressed and they're in too much pain, I wonder what would be the data of the thing, but you know, probably that's sort of new, and then it's semi-legal in many places, so maybe the neuroscientists haven't gotten around to going into
it. Could also be that this is at a much more subtle level than and that equipment can pick up.
So, but the llamas could, because they kind of know the signs of death, could volunteer to go to that place and go through the process in that place.
Well, yeah, maybe.
Yeah. Listen, it's only suggested.
Propose it.
Yeah. Maybe I should volunteer, but I know it's a high
level. No, don't volunteer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You should live a long time. And
it will be.
A last thing, which...
This video was brought to you in part through the generous support of the Tibet House US membership community. To learn about the benefits of Tibet House membership, including special Dosset tours with Robert Thurman and friends with geographic expeditions, please visit tibethouse.us. Thanks for watching, and Tashi Dilek.